Hello and welcome to Tech This Week, where we bring you up to speed with the most important developments in the enterprise and emerging technology space in India. In today's episode, we'll talk about Azure taking cloud computing to space, a snapshot at the growing tech startups in Bangladesh in the light of recent fundraise by ShopUp, how the festive sales are faring for the Indian e-commerce companies, and the biggest funding deals of the week. Joining me in today's episode from the Tech Circle newsroom are Payal Ganguly, Vignesh Anantraj, and Devangana Ghosh. So let's start with the healthy sales figure that the e-commerce companies have been posting during their online festive sales. And I think COVID-19 hasn't deterred consumers' online purchasing pattern any bit. The sales figures, which have been coming, are pretty much the same as last year's. Just a very similar number on the mobile phones and consumer electronics that have been gaining a lot of traction. And any other particular trends that you guys have been noticing?
Frankly, to note some of the key trends in this year's online festive sales, obviously focusing on the bigger two, Flipkart and Amazon. So what we have seen is that these e-commerce platforms have been aggressively pushing credit products and pay later schemes to ensure that the festive cheer and obviously the demand uptick is there. So what we have seen in the past few months is that the consumer sentiments have obviously been pretty low, job losses, overall lack of business opportunity, and more so now that we see that the festivities are not happening with the pomp that it usually happens. But cut to the first 24 hours of the sales, we saw that Amazon had already managed to disburse rupees 600 crores worth of credit through its pay later scheme. And for Flipkart, throughout the overall sale period, they have seen a 60% increase in device and appliance insurance as compared to the numbers that they saw in 2019. But before the sales started, Redseer Consulting had estimated that this year we are the overall gross merchandise value of the shopping period is going to be of around $7 billion. But then, and this is in fact more than over 100% increase from the $3.8 billion worth of GMV that the online e-commerce platforms did through sales last year. But so that's what the estimates have been so far, and we are yet to get the updated numbers on it.
So Devangana, in terms of any numbers, can you throw some numbers in terms of how much these e-commerce companies have garnered in number of sales over the past 24 hours or through the particular period?
Yes, right. So the numbers we have right now is that in the first 4 days of the sales, I believe they have managed to gain around $4 billion. So, and the rest of the numbers are yet to come out. But the first 4 days of the sales, yeah, they have managed to surpass the estimates and somewhat reach $4 billion. But yeah, the updated numbers are
pretty huge. That is still pretty huge, right? So Payal, what's happening in terms of consumer behavior? Is there a major shift that we are witnessing?
See, Vignesh, the thing is, there has been a lot of pent-up demand, right? The malls have been closed till very recently. And also, especially when we look at from the perspective of tier 2, 3 cities, the supply chains have been disrupted. So the demand is driving a lot of the shopping behavior which we see right now. So Flipkart said that almost 50% of its new customers were coming from tier 3 cities. Another factor which we need to consider is the work from home scenario, right? Since most of the companies have said that, you know, their workforces will be, working from home and remotely till at least January. So we've seen a spike in that category, which includes furniture, electric, digital equipment like smartphones, tablets, laptops, also because of the e-learning classes which are going on. The smartphone sales are expected to cover more than 45% of the total online GMV, which is very much keeping in trend from the previous years. Amazon saw 300% increase in tablet sales, which I'm guessing is mostly directed at the students who are taking online classes. Flipkart saw a 3.5 million unit sale of audio devices and accessories just within this 5-day period. So one of which is, I think, Shweta, if she has already bought her AirPods.
Not yet. No, and the festivities remind me, guys, how are you guys celebrating Durga Puja this time? Going to for pandal hopping or not?
Not much, actually. I'm mostly staying at home and binging on food, and I managed to buy a couple of books on the sales, which will keep me covered up during the weekend. And yes, today I am planning to visit one of the neighborhood pandals, I guess.
I'm just celebrating this amazing background, guys.
Check it out.
Isn't it the best? Vignesh, you should be called the national bird of
Vignesh Tech Circle. The peacock.
Vignesh, the Tech Circle peacock. Okay. That's really lame, but okay.
I know. But then, Devangna, you know, not everybody is that lucky stepping out, etc. I think Supriya has taken a break, gone to Kolkata, a regular feature on the podcast. Yeah.
Speaking of which, didn't we see Sequoia India making their first investment in Bangladesh this week?
That's a strange correlation, Shweta. I don't know, Supriya. I think went to
Calcutta, Bangladesh.
But yeah, the this B2B platform, Shopper, it did raise $22.5 million from Sequoia India, and it is it provides digital tech stack to mom and pop stores in Bangladesh.
So, Payal, isn't it the same company which had recently acquired Vonik?
Not the entire operation, Vignesh, but they did acquire Vonik's B2B and tech platform in February. So, the co-founders of Vonik, Sujayat Ali and Navneet Krishnan, joined the merged entity as, again, co-founders.
Yeah, who would have thought? I haven't tracked the Bangladesh startup ecosystem per se, but yeah, unlike say rest of the Southeast Asia, even though their per capita GDP is higher than India, this is according to an IMF report which was published recently.
Well, not commenting on the macroeconomics here, but yes, the Southeast Asian startup ecosystem is a lot better known than probably Bangladesh. And this is a thriving startup ecosystem, which has a lot of parallels with the Indian startup ecosystem. I think both started more or less, within a few years of gap of each other.
Amazon does not ship to Bangladesh, right?
Yeah, they don't yet, but they do a lot of sourcing from sellers in Bangladesh. Also, I read reports recently which said that Amazon wants to get into Bangladesh. However, it has its own, e-commerce website, which is Rocket Internet backed Daraz.com, as well as omni-channel player Deligram, which has kind of pivoted to the offline from its offline to online commerce to more of a B2B operation.
And I've also heard that there is an online bike sharing and food delivery company called Patao.
Patao in Bengali means to send. So.
Okay. And it's backed by Gojek, and there are other venture capital backed companies like Services Marketplace, Shiba, and Ticket Booking Platform. Shohos, what are these names?
Shohos means Bangla names.
Easy. Shohos. Yeah, I hope I'm pronouncing them right.
Yeah.
Would be interesting to see a comparison actually of these kind of internet companies across the two countries.
Yeah, I mean, to cut in there, Devangna, actually, Pathao is probably one of the more well-funded ones in the Bangladesh ecosystem, like Vignesh said, right? Gojek was one of its earliest backers, and it is the equivalent of, say, Gojek in Bangladesh. They started as a bike sharing, ride-hailing platform. But they have kind of diversified into food delivery, among other services. So, yeah, it's quite interesting to see how they are developing, independent of, say, an Indian ecosystem where there is something which focuses only on food, say, like a Swiggy or Zomato, or a Dunzo-like model, which kind of focuses only on, consumer-generated demand for shipping products. Yeah.
Right. Also, guys, this week we saw Microsoft taking cloud computing to space and they're calling it Azure Space. So is it something very similar to the AWS Aerospace and Satellite Solutions, which they had launched, I think, back in July?
Okay, moving from Bangladesh and right into space. Exactly, Shweta. It is Microsoft's answer to the aerospace and the satellite solutions offered by AWS. And here, if you know, past year, Microsoft already got the upper hand, where if you remember, AWS lost out to a contract to provide cloud computing services to the Pentagon, which was estimated to be around $10 billion. So the Azure space is most probably the solution built by Microsoft to primarily help the Pentagon and also to cater to the entire space industry. So there is a lot of money being spent on the cloud and space research. Debangana, do you have any clue as to why this is happening?
Franklin, one word if I have to say, it's mainly due to defense. So especially in the US, the strategy of the Department of Defense is to move away from the large and old satellites, which are geostationary, to something slightly smaller and more versatile networks that can be launched more frequently and can carry out way more tasks with more agility, actually.
Oh, that makes a lot of sense. So I heard that through Azure Space, Microsoft will offer simulation of space missions, interpretation of satellite data, as well as global satellite networking capabilities through partnerships such as the one that they recently announced with SpaceX. SpaceX and Microsoft are building an Azure modular data center, as they call it. This is very similar to the type of data centers that Microsoft put in the oceans. So these can be deployed in remote locations and can operate off-grid using its own network. That is pretty cool. And in the future could prove to be a very powerful weapon. Should I call it a weapon? I don't think. Okay, guys, I did not use the term weapon.
We'll try to edit that.
Frankly, a fun fact here would be that a lot of Indian smaller startups like Pixel or Kava Space, they are also looking at doing this kind of things, you know, getting data from satellites and then deploying it to the client companies. So a lot of similar things are happening. But yeah, obviously, if Microsoft, SpaceX and AWS come to the equation, so it would be interesting to see how the industry shapes up in the coming years.
Yeah, and moving on to the funding deals of the week, there was AI-based banking solutions provider Signzy, which raised $5.4 million from MasterCard and Akram Ventures.
Yes, and today we are joined by the CEO of Signzy, who spoke to me about what the deal means for the company and what type of new solution deployments they have. Let's hear from him.
This year there has a lot of demand and pressure on our customer base to digitize quickly. And our funding that we are raising is directly aligned with that goal of our end customers. Primarily, we will be investing it in two areas. One is deepening on our product capabilities around AI and automation, which will help our customers build far more complex solutions to solve their problems. And the other is around global reach and global growth. One of the goals is to also start giving our solutions to customers in US and Middle East, and the part of the funding will be used to create that solution. In a hyper growth year, and in terms of customers, we've grown to about 50 customers to over 150 customers this year. We've grown across geographies in these customers. So we have now customers in Middle East, we have customers in US. And we've been able to really do a really good job where today the top 5 banks work with us, the top HDFCs work with us, the top 5 AMCs work with us. Almost who's who of the industry trust and work with Signzy. Apart from our customer growth, we also grown as a team. We've grown from a team of 40 odd people to about 120 people. And also, there are a lot of offers out. And so I think we would be almost 150 people by the end of the year. In terms of our product, we are seeing higher and higher adoption. So while last year we had about a million API hits a month, today we are seeing over 5 million if they hit a month, so almost 5x growth in terms of product adoption as well. So at the current times have been extremely interesting and tough for the industry. It's become plainly obvious that whatever may be your use case, whatever industry segment you may be in, digital is no longer a choice, it's a necessity. This requires for a lot of traditional institutions to rework their legacy infra and read about how they distribute product to the end customer. And finally, the key part of the transformation over the next year, REI would be powering a lot of the products that you use as consumers. The goal is to help our customers make this journey from a traditional financial services with brick and mortar branches to an agility the kind seen in Facebook, Amazon, and Netflix.
Thank you so much for joining. And another interesting company that raised funding this week was cloud company Tachyon, which became a unicorn after raising $150 million in its Series C round, which was led by private equity investor Advent International. The company offers automotive OEMs a retail operating platform through SaaS model. And it said that it will use the fresh capital for the platform's development and expansion.
Also, Shweta, another interesting funding deal was Gurgaon-based Pocket FM, which raised $5 million from Tencent as well as Lightspeed India and BCCL. And Slintel, which is a Bangalore-based sales and marketing intelligence platform, has raised around $4.2 million in a fresh round of funding led by AXA.
Well, with that, it's a wrap on this episode of Tech This Week. Do stay tuned in and logged on to techcircle.in for more interesting news and updates. And a happy Dashera to all of you.
Happy Dashera. Bye-bye. Bye, Shweta.